Hello, everybody, and welcome to yet another edition of Paradigm Shift and Educational Comedy. And me and Katerina are here speaking with Isabelle Rizo. Did I pronounce that right?
Isabelle Rizo, yes.
Isabelle Rizo, okay. On the topic of succeeding through authenticity. Each of us are exchanging notes on our own perspective journeys, which are obviously still not concluded and are still well underway. One of the major dilemmas that we humans face is judging ourselves harshly about where we're currently at while we're in the process of getting to where we're going, because humans are just neurotic little fuckers like that, aren't we? Our inner critic will be far more harsh than any external one, so this hangout intends to show you how to make it easier for you to be more kind to yourself as you progress through your own life's journey. And before we hit the broadcast button, we were kind of talking about exactly that. I was saying that, you know, well, Isabelle was saying that she's done trying to convince people of anything, and I'm just like, well, as I like to say, it's impossible to convince anybody of everything. You can only just be an example of the change you want to create. Then people are like, but Dave, then why are you up there talking and saying stuff and blah, blah, blah? And it's like, well, A, I have the right to be me, so thank you for that. And two, because like-minded people haven't mastered telepathy yet and I can't do Mark Cohen Larson and, you know, get all the like-minded people to come. So I have to, like, speak up, hey, I'm here. And unfortunately, when you do that, you don't just get like-minded people, you get not-so-like-minded people as well. So... yeah, I guess, you know, people just kind of expect me to master telepathy or something. I don't know. But anyway, I'm not here to convince anybody of anything, and neither is Isabelle, and neither is Katerina. We're just here being ourselves, and if you like that, cool. And if you don't, suck a dick. I mean, I respect your right to have an opinion. And you know, that's a big thing. I call it benevolent trolling, because people just don't know how to respond when you authentically respect their right to their opinion. Like, they come up like, oh, you suck, and you're crazy, and fuck you. But it's like, well, I respect your right to you having your opinion. I mean, I obviously don't agree with you, and I think you're a scumbag and can go suck a dick. But I do respect your right to be you and to express that, and I'm not going to sit here and say, oh, you have no right to tell me that. You think I'm crazy. I think you're a fuckhead. Great. That's awesome. We both have our perspectives. We're allowed to. And I respect that. And they're like, wait, what? You were supposed to tell me that I did something wrong by saying that to you, and that I'm a poo-poo head, and you were supposed to fight me. Why aren't you fighting me? I can't feel justified now. What the hell? Yeah, it's really interesting. It makes life more drama-free, though, because then you're totally disgusting and insufferable to those people, and they go away. And then that leaves only the people worth dealing with in your reality, so...
I can vouch for this.
Yeah. So, Isabelle, not to put you on the spot, but tell us a bit about you. I've obviously only recently met you, and you're apparently a fellow Chicagoan.
Yay! Yes.
You invited me somewhere before I could even invite you to the coffee. The good old days when the guys beat the lady to the punch. Not just but, you know... I think
that's a great segue into the conversation. But I guess an intro is because people.
Yeah, I'm still learning who you are, and everybody needs to know who you are. So tell us who you are. Well, I shut the hell up.
So my name is Isabelle Rizo, and I have been a digital nomad for a while, a travel blogger, a consultant, an artist, a filmmaker. I've worn many different hats, but the whole thread that goes through everything that I do is storytelling. I just love listening, discovering, and sharing other stories. And I'm actually pivoting the way I'm doing my business with brands and with visionaries, that they have a platform just like we're doing right now, and they want to get clear on their brand, they want to get clear on their voice, they want to get clear on this, and what is their authentic story. So it's basically like the essence of their brand. And then I help them use film, books, blogging, social media, and all of these tools that we have available to us to share that with like-minded people that message resonates with them. Because we don't have to convince everybody that our message is the right one, but if you're coming from an authentic place and you're doing a full expression of you and your highest self, then, I mean, I believe that's what everyone on this planet has the possibility of doing, just exploring who they are and then having a natural expression of that here in this reality. So I use that storytelling tools to help them get their story out.
Love that.
Okay, and because I usually talk way too much, I'm going to let Katerina chime in next.
What, follow up? So how do you do that, Isabelle? Do you do that through your one-on-ones, or do you do it through groups, or how do you actually meet with these people and sort escort them through that process?
Yeah, so like I mentioned before, this is a transition because I've been doing it on like a micro scale for a while now, but then I had a few opportunities to help on some national campaigns and things like that, and I was like, I like this national campaign stuff. And then being a digital nomad, just that means you run your business from your laptop and you could have a team from around the world, because that's the future of work right now. It's like you don't have to be in an office. You could work with people from all over. I meet up with them one-on-one through Skype, usually because people are from all over the world, and I'm like, I don't want to fly out and meet you because I don't feel like it. So let's just Skype because it's cost efficient. And we walk through the whole story. I interview them. I ask them, like, it's almost like the brand has to, we go deep into the psychology of the brand. We create, it's like a character creation almost. Mm-hmm. And then who, like, what's their story? What are the colors that they like? What's the color represent here? And it's like all this dissecting and creating a character of a brand. Because a lot of us really are kind of characters in this whole earth. We're like the earth is our playground, or it's our theater, and then we can do whatever the heck we want. And so I help them create that character. And that's through a Skype call, but then I also work with, I just met up a filmmaker when I was in Belgium, and then I have a web design agency that I work with, and then I have some content creators that I work with that they love, like, everyone, this is why I was like, everybody has their highest self. They all have different things they love. So I have my virtual assistant that is organized. I am not. I'm just like, I can give you the vision and dissect all of this, but I cannot organize this. So your highest self and highest thing that you love doing is organizing. Then I have the UX developer. Then I have the filmmaker that does the, you know.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but aren't you originally from Germany or somewhere in Europe? Or?
Well, that's a whole other story. But both
your accent is what my ex-girlfriend used to refer to as well-traveled. We traveled the world a lot. That's how I ended up meeting her in the first place. And, her accent, I'm like, where are you from? I can't pinpoint it. And, you know... And another girl I met from Europe too had like a well-traveled accent. Although my ex-girlfriend was Finnish, so when she really got into like that Finnish mode, especially with like the rolling of the R's that I totally can't do. I have what they refer to in Finland as having an R problem. I probably know what that means. You're probably familiar.
Yes, you can't go.
I think I learned more about Europe from her in 3 months than I've learned ever.
Yeah, yeah. It's well, both my parents are from Romania. They left after the revolution, and then I was born in Germany. But then we were given the option to either go to the UK, South Africa, where apartheid was happening, and they were like, "Please, white people, come down," and we're like, "No," or the West. So we're like, let's just go to the U.S. and then,
when people come down and be segregated and spit upon, and no, thank you.
Yeah. See, that was a story that was happening down there that we were like, that doesn't resonate with us. So
let's see. Do I want to be shunned, ostracized? And no, it doesn't really sound like fun. Not going for it.
Yes.
Well, Isabelle, back to you after that segue. I want to let you finish that thought that you had, because I know Dave sometimes has this tendency of sidelining. But, you know, I'm the one that brings us back, so here we go.
So, I
appreciate her interruptions.
So I meet up with them on Skype, and then sometimes I get all of us all together and then run through, like, this big vision. Usually it's, like, 3 to 6 months. Like it could be a film, it could be an art gallery showing, it could be a book launch, it could be whatever it is, because that's just content, that's just stuff we create. And I ask them what they love to do, what's their budget, because you can use social media for free to share your story. And I have entrepreneurs that reach out to me, and they're like, I spent $800 on print advertising, and I'm like, what was your return on investment? It's like, well, nobody signed up for my class. And I'm like, oh, no, who gave you this advice? Because everyone starts off, you know, I'm like, no, don't. So everyone starts off at different levels. And that's why I ask, like, what's your budget? What does your vision look like? And if your vision is all the way up here, but you're just starting out here, maybe it's good to just use these free resources and then a little bit of paid resources and then grow. So I evaluate where they're at, and then I give them a little bit of a strategy, and I refer them out to other people, because I was of the mindset for the longest time. I was the punk zinester, you know, like DIY everything. And now I'm at the point where, wait, I don't have to DIY everything. Like, I can let other people shine and do their own films and publish books, and I could just tell people what to do. What?
I can resonate with that. I myself, this period of entrepreneurship that I've been on for like the past 4 years or so, I've worn a lot of hats myself. A lot of people don't know all the different hats that I've worn, just because I present, you know, just what I do on social media as a healer and all of that. And, you know, I've built people websites. I have done their Facebook ads. I've done their MailChimp campaign and stuff.
I like your leather hat with the metal spikes. I'm totally kidding.
What?
Talking about all the hats, I'm like, I like your leather hat. With the
gotcha. Okay. So, yeah, like, I've done a lot of different stuff, and I have a lot of different skills, and I'm a very DIY person. I love learning. I love absorbing myself in all of that, and, you know, it's been this year that I've relinquished a lot of those hats, because they weren't fun. Like, they weren't that much fun for me to do that anymore, and, you know, other people definitely can shine in them a lot better. And
they love it, and they're like, here, I'm just like, you love this, and you shine at this, here, take my money, because I want you to shine, because I was doing, like you said, all the different hats, the Google ads, Google Analytics, and I was geeking out about that stuff, because at that time, that's what was meant for me to learn so that I can pass it on to somebody else. And I've done film, I've done writing and all this, but now I'm like, I don't have to do everything. I know I'm really, really good at this, and I could end up doing this for the rest of my life, and I can let other people shine. And that was, I'm a control freak, and I was the last person that, you know,
My friend Rebecca Jernigan likes to say we are all recovering control freaks. That's just like a part of the paradigm shifting process.
Yes, and I'm like, this is good. I can let go. And that's the word that kept coming up was let go.
How do I do that?
Well, no, though, I think we've all noticed just that in that letting go, you are able to let things evolve. You know, Dave and I were talking about this the other day. I mean, he had a channel, like a paradigm shift channel that had like over 6 million views, and then it got taken down by YouTube for DMCA whatevers.
No, it wasn't DMCA. It was pure censorship. I didn't get any strikes.
Pure censorship. Okay.
Everything was all good, and they're just like...
Yeah, so he had been building that for like 2, 3, 4 years. 4 years.
Wow.
And so now he's rebuilding his second channel again.
I was making grand a month when they can me. So like it kinda sucks to take the pay reduction, but I'm like, well, if I did it in 4, this time I'll do it in 2.
Yeah.
Right. Well, he built it up a lot faster, and some of the videos that have been going, you know, getting a lot of hits have been some of the ones from me, and I'm just like, what the hell? Like,
The interwebs likes you.
Apparently. But I'm saying that it's interesting how when we let go to the newness, you know, all of these new things start popping up. You know, now we have like this little pact of people that we call PSEC crew.
For me, this is the way I explain it. PSEC crew is not a group that people join. PSEC crew is a worded label that I have put on something that I am observing that has its own momentum.
An energy.
It's its own formation. And instead of saying, oh, that thing over there that's doing stuff, I just, like, you know, put a label on it because we're human and, you know, keep things not so confusing.
Yep. But it's fascinating, though, because he let go of what his old channel was and what it needed to be. It's morphing into this new thing. And I think that as entrepreneurs, we really need to be flexible and be able to allow the natural developments and movements, like myself included. I had to let go of, you know, being the everything for everyone.
Yeah.
And
I think that's
still allow myself to bloom.
That's really why I seem to have won my IMB, which is an acronym I use. It stands for Illuminati Merit Badge. It's when the corporate powers that be say, we don't like you, and it just, like, gives you more credibility. But I think I kind of needed that to happen because I could see that, like, the direction my old channel was going, I wanted to focus more on, okay, this is what's happening in the world, these are the dichotomies, and, you know, what solutions can we, you know, do to fix the problems? And I think I was attracting way too many conspiracy nuts. The Illuminati are going to kill us all! And I think I was getting a demographic that didn't necessarily resonate with what I was really looking to do. Mm-hmm. So, like, within this reboot of my channel, I've been getting more and more people that actually resonate with what I'm looking to do instead of all these crazies that are just waking up. And I'm not trying to bash them. I mean, it's just, we're all crazy at first. You know, it's like, what's going on? You know, we got the shock when we start to realize that the world isn't the fairy tale that we've been taught it is, and Prince Charming isn't going to come to your rescue, and if you are Prince Charming, then guess what? The damsel in distress and the dragon are the same damn thing. We've got issues. So, you know, it's like, you know, people wake up into this, so at first there's the fear reaction, so they're looking for someone to blame, someone to shake their fist at. They're not really thinking about, okay, here's the mess, we need to clean it up, what solutions can we go to? They're more like, I was attracting too many of those people that I wasn't really, you know, wanting to do that. And I was really wanting to, like, you know, align with people who are willing to work together and be the change that we want to create. And as soon as I let go of my belief that said, you know, I'm not attracting those people, I'm just attracting all these crazies, you know, as soon as I, like, let go of that, my channel went by, and now it's, like, reboot. Now I'm attracting, you know, more people, and, like, this whole PSEC crew has been, like, forming itself. This has been something new that's been happening with the new channel, like, you know, God, the universe, whatever you want to call it, just kind of saying, see, Dave, look, just allow, let go.
Yes.
Don't be such a fucking control freak, and, you know, just kind of roll with the flow and let like-minded people come in, and instead of sitting there going, like, what the fuck, why aren't I getting any like-minded people?
Yep.
So, yeah.
That's an organic growth that I absolutely love, and it's not, because I have people that say, oh, I want to have 1 million likes on my Facebook page, and 1 million followers, and I say, okay, this is like asking, how do I become the most popular kid in school? Are you going to be everyone for everything, you know, everything for everyone? Or are you just going to be yourself and attract the right people and organically grow at a much faster rate?
Yeah, my view on it is, like, you can totally do that, but a lot of people expect to plant a tree seed today and have a 40-foot tree tomorrow,
yep.
And it just doesn't work that way. Mm-hmm. Things take time. But we're taught to view time as the enemy because yep. We're taught to think, I'm poor little me, I'm never good enough. Mom and dad said I'm not good enough. Teacher said I'm not good enough. Society says I'm not good enough. I'm not good enough. I'm not qualified. I'm not capable. Therefore, I have to have everything now. Because if there's any time that passes, all that time is just opportunity for me to screw myself over and for other people to screw me over and all this dangerous territory. So time bad. I need everything now. Because if I don't get it now, then this enemy is going to be at my gate here to screw with me. And that's really not the way life works. We can drive ourselves neurotically crazy and make all sorts of catastrophic mistakes that have nasty consequences, that then we could psychologically project and say, see, there's proof that that's the way life works, when really that's not how life works. That's just, hey, you did something stupid, there's a consequence there, and it's just, yeah, what you put out, you get back, and that's not even airy-fairy or philosophical. That's as simple as, you hit your hand with a hammer, it's going to fucking hurt. There's really no getting around the logic. So, nothing mystical about it.
You know, it's really interesting that you're bringing that up, because this kind of ties back in with the whole succeeding through authenticity thing that, you know, this hangout is titled. I was talking with, I posted this last a couple nights ago in a group that I'm a part of, and I was just, I was noticing inside of me like this weird feeling, and I don't know whether or not it's because of my age or because like the nature of what I do or the circles that I'm around, is it's just like this feeling of being behind, like I'm not there, like oh no, like, and I think that there's a lot of pressure on us, especially as entrepreneurs, like get results, go move, like you got to make something happen, you know, otherwise you're irrelevant and insignificant.
Run fast in a hamster wheel, get nowhere, really quick.
Yes, it's a hamster wheel thing. And I was just noticing like this energy moving through me, and you know, obviously I do energy work and stuff like that, so I was just like, whoa, okay, so what is this? I'm going to like look at this, like bring this out and be like, oh shit, like that is something that has been running my life for like the past decade.
Yep.
And this thing that where it's like, no matter what you do, it's never enough. It's no matter what you do, like you're always somehow behind the ball. Mm-hmm. And you can't really celebrate the successes that you're having because you're looking out and being like, oh my God, they're so much further ahead than me. Ah! You know, and I'm like 23 years old. Like, what the hell am I thinking? I have a whole life ahead of me. I'm a baby in this circle. Like, I have so much time.
Yeah.
I really do.
I think I had a similar experience a few months ago when I went to, I was in Germany, and I was getting into like my whole morning ritual thing where I was like really intentional about it. So I made my cup of tea, and I brought my little journal, and I brought my watercolor pencils, and I sat in the back, and it was raining.
You sacrificed virgins to Zeus, just kidding. You said ritual, so.
Oh. And I was sitting down, and I was just observing inside and out, and I was like, oh my God, I'm doing what I want to do, what I kept dreaming about, and I'm not even acknowledging that I'm doing it.
Right?
Guilty!
Guilty! Guilty, all of us.
You know,
all of us, seriously.
I was just sitting, and I broke down. I was like, wow! And I'm, you know, and all of my clients know, like, when I'm coaching, they're like, they tell me, like, you're intimidating. You keep, you know, it's like, doing this, like, move forward, move fast, because it's a lot of, like, masculine. Mm-hmm. The masculine, I think, is very action, and the mm-hmm. feminine is very holding space. And yeah. I combined both of that together. As entrepreneurs, we have to do that, because we're combining all that energetic force from all these different places. And then I was like, wow, I was completely disregarding the feminine.
You make a really good point. People seem to have this or that attitude, mm-hmm. like opposites fight, instead of having a this and that attitude. Mm-hmm. And I think the biggest like global expression of that is the idea of individualism versus collectivism.
Mm.
Because both need to exist, because collectives are made up of sovereign individuals. So you kind of need both, because, yeah, you're a single individual, but you're also a part of collective groups. So that's why when people focus too much on individualism, they end up spiraling straight into freaking collectivism. Let's be different like everyone else, and it becomes like a meme. And then, of course, if you're one of these Nazi Führers that's trying to get everybody into Borgish collectivism, you're really diving deep into individualism, because you're saying, I'm an individual and I know what's best for everybody else out there. And if you don't conform to me, I will send my Gestapo after you and toss you into some mess, you know. So, I mean, there's this nasty dichotomy, because people aren't realizing that individualism and collectivism have to exist. That's why all these entrepreneurs are like, in order for me to succeed, I have to cast myself out into the desert, away from friends and family and colleagues, and abandon myself and do everything totally on my own with no whatsoever.
Yes.
I'm a failure. It's like, I'm sorry, but there's no successful person out there ever who has ever done anything completely alone. Mm-hmm. That's like saying, I want to build a house, so instead of hiring the contracting crew and the architects and simply being the one that's guiding them and saying, okay, I want this here, this there, that, I'm going to try to do the whole thing myself.
Yes.
I'm going to get out the shovel and the construction equipment, and oh, I just drilled a hole through my hand and broke my leg, and oh, crap.
Love that you bring that up, because there's now and I was part of it too, where I had the idea for a tiny house. And it's the response to the McMansion, everybody collectively, I want a big house, and it's like the pendulum swinging the other way and be like, no, I'm DIYing my tiny house by myself, and I can do it, and blah, 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 blah. And that's a wonderful, you know, but it's an expression, again, of the pendulum swinging to the other side.
Hire people to build your tiny house.
Yes, yes, exactly. And, like, tiny house communities.
I don't need a mansion, but I'd love a lot of property, mainly because I'm like, a nature nut. I live like on a typical Chicago property. I mean, one of these days, wait till you see what I have going on here. I have a massive, beautiful garden of both flowers and vegetables. I actually have a 6-foot-deep pond in the backyard that I built myself, and I have a pond in my basement that also built. So, and I also
and aquariums and
other YouTube. I have a whole other YouTube channel for that too.
Pondscape.
Yep, and I sell fish to the local pet stores and stuff, and, you know, so I raise fish and I grow garden stuff, and I'm also a huge computer geek, so the whole house is wired with, you know, RJ45 networking. Bedroom looks like Mission Control. You can see back there.
Yeah.
Oh, look at all the, yeah, I'm like the phone and internet hub for, like, the whole everything here. It's just like, you know, it almost seems like a contradiction, like technology.
We can have contradictions,
yeah,
existing at the same time. I think Elizabeth Gilbert just talked about, like, we can have the scientific mind, but we can have the artistic mind at the same time. Sometimes they seem to be at odds with each other, but really they are so beautifully interwoven together that that's why I go back to personal responsibility. If it wasn't for me sitting down that one day, observing the rain, realizing that I was my pendulum was going in this direction, instead of, hey, you know, I can probably be balanced here in the middle, then I cannot reflect that out into my reality with the people that I attract, with the clients that I bring in, with the stories and the work that I do. So it's always a constant bringing yourself back.
You know what nature is, might seem ironic. You know what nature has taught me about technology? When you understand nature, you understand the physics of things, and then you can use technology in such a way that lets nature actually work with it and do most,
yes,
of the work for you. Because you don't have to pay it. You know, you really don't. It's not expecting any money. And it works on its own automatically and has done so since the beginning of the freaking universe. So that's there to do. And
it's when we're resisting those laws of the universe that chaos ensues. But, I mean, the thing is, though, in the universe, there is chaos, and that is part of reality. So I think when we negatively, we put a judgment or a label on that chaos, like, oh, I'm doing this as an entrepreneur, and this is bad. It's not bad. It's completely natural.
The end point that I'm working towards here is that I found out that if I design, you know, like my pond stuff and all that, based on how nature works, instead of thinking, oh, I have to buy these products at the store that they say are for ponds, then nature is doing most of the work for me. So that's like a whole lot of money I'm not spending, a whole lot of equipment I'm not using, because I'm going with nature's flow. And it's like, wow, instead of buying all this equipment, I've got a filtration construct that is based around how nature operates naturally. So I got just like one pump, pumping water into it, instead of all these mechanisms and an algae removal mechanism and a big canister filter that gets stinky that you got to change out once a week, and all this money spent on all this hardware. It's like, wow, I have this one pump. Pump puts water here. The water goes there. Nature takes care of it completely. I don't ever have to clean anything. And the water comes out clean the other side. And all the plants that are in there, they convert all that yuck and that ammonia and all that to plant material. And then I just go in with my scissors and I prune it and I mulch it into the garden. And the garden really appreciates that because it's really highly fertile. Mm-hmm. So it's just like nature takes care of everything instead of spending like $3,000 on all this pond equipment and shit. It's like, okay, I built my own little bog filter. I have one pump. It was really cheap and easy and just, yeah, there you go. And I don't have to pay nature to do anything.
Yep.
What would you say the equivalent of that is in the entrepreneur world for you, Isabelle?
I think it goes back to allowing and listening, seeing what the trends are around you, like noticing around you what's going on, but then going inward and seeing what your strengths and natural inclinations are, following that exciting curiosity that you have, acting inspired, like having inspired action in that direction that can serve others, as serving others always being the pivotal like focus in your mind. Because then naturally synchronicity occurs and opportunities appear, like this interview, for example. For 2 weeks, I haven't been working. Like, I have been working a tiny bit, but everything inside me is like, do not work. Wait, do not work. Because for 7 years now, I've been nonstop. I always have to create something. I always have to make something. I always have to please everyone. And it's like, slow down. What do you like to do? Just focus on that, but you don't have to do anything. You know, create that space. Because as entrepreneurs, we were like, we have all of the hats. I have to do my website, my social media, my marketing, my onboarding, my bringing in leads, blah, blah, blah. When in reality, everything that was successful for me was...
Naturally?
Yeah, was just natural. Like, it just would happen. And it was without a lot of effort.
You know, I've seen...
Oh, yeah.
I've really seen good examples of that, like, within social media. Like, even with all the season flow we have with social media, right, people are still under the impression that they have to suffer and struggle and slave and all this and that. And even the big social media owners, like, you know, like Zuckerberg owns Facebook, even he has that mentality about it. And like there's this new social media platform that I'm on called TSU. It's some people call it SU, however you want to pronounce it. It's a really awesome new paradigm. Basically, you share content, and just like every other social media, you know, network, like, you know how Facebook has their little ads and stuff? Mm-hmm. Well, TSU gives the users 90% of the ad revenue, and then they take their 10% and they invest it in bigger markets to get returns to then expand. And people, Zuckerberg has totally blackballed and censored TSU on Facebook because he's feeling threatened by this paradigm. It's like, wait a minute, if this catches on and Twitter and Pinterest and all these others start using that economic model, then in order to survive in this world, I'm going to have to give away 90% of my ad revenue on the same system, and I'm a greedy bitch who's thinking I have to suffer and slave and hoard everything and not share and be a disgruntled control freak, and I don't like change.
Well, we don't. That's a natural human response. It's like change, me changing who I am, me changing a character that I've been for my entire life to something like completely different. 180. you won't. That's completely uncomfortable.
People are starting to make money hand over fist on TSU. It's really not that hard, but it is one of those systems that it's all about the journey. You know, you're going to make money in the long run, not the short run, just by keeping on sharing and building up your following. And people who are into instant gratification are like, no, I want 500,000 followers now and $10,000 a month now and blah, blah, blah. But it's really all about the journey. And one thing that really blew my mind, like, on this thing, like, you have followers and friends. Now, as many people can follow you as you know, whatever, it's no limit, but you can only have 5,000 friends, and you can only, you know, follow 1,000 people. Now, there's over 5 million users on TSU right now, so out of 5 million, you can only follow 1,000. You will never guess who picked me to be one of their 1,000 that they're following.
Cool.
Sebastian Zubcheck, the CEO of TSU, apparently doing something right. I saw that, I'm like, what?
But that is a perfect example.
He tags me stuff too, and I'm like.
Did you tell him hello?
Huh?
Did you tell him hello?
He added me as a friend on Facebook too.
Yeah, I mean, did you reach out and say hi?
Yeah, he's obviously busy, and I'm sure he's really busy with the lawyers, like, dealing with Facebook and all this other nasty stuff, but we don't like, communicate, like, private conversation yet. It hasn't gone that direction, but we communicate publicly in messages, like, tagging each other and stuff and whatever, and he'll comment, like, you know, interesting video, smile, or he'll be like, I think you might be interested in this, and he'll, like, tag me and you know, in something else and whatever.
You could be a brand ambassador for TSU. Sorry, this is what I do for a living. I'm, like, connecting.
Well, I understand, and I mean, I think this is one of those opportunities for me to realize that, like, I don't have to, like, rush into this at a neurotic pace and, like, totally freaking jump Sebastian, you know? It's like, let him observe me for a while, let me observe him, and take that natural, you know, comfortable flow. Because, like, you know, if him and I were to ever work together on anything, which I don't know if we will, but, you know, if it goes in that
direction, we will, because you're making that your reality.
But it's better to go at a natural flow into that rather than, like, neurotically going 90 miles an hour into the brick wall like we've been trained to do, you know? Yeah. Yes, Katerina, please speak your mind.
Well, I was just saying that that's a perfect example of what we were just talking about. Like, you know, this, I don't know about you, Isabelle, but did you learn social media marketing in such a way where it felt very neurotic and stressful? Like,
Well, you know, everything I was doing was organic, and it was successful and great. And then I fell into the trap of going into that neurotic training.
Empower Network.
Yes, I did that too. I had my training with Empower Network, which was, you know, like an affiliate marketing company that I was super into like a couple years ago. And, you know, it totally almost killed my passion for social media. Like, it just, because it felt so routine and robotic and spammy and all of it. And it just totally stole the joy that I had from authentically sharing.
Mm-hmm. And then can I be fair about my own observations with Empower Network?
It was me.
Yeah, I think Empower Network is a completely great, wonderful tool, and it works. But the thing about tools is that you can't use a hammer for everything. And not everything is everyone's cup of tea. And a lot of people put the tools on the pedestal and worship the tools as gods and go, oh, almighty tool, you are going to make it rain money if I worship you enough. Oh, great, omnipotent tool. Yeah. And they're not seeing it as it's just a tool. And so Empower Network is really awesome and wonderful for those who resonate with it, for those who get good at the tool. Like, you know, if you're good at music and not good at painting, you're not going to try to use a paintbrush to play the piano. That's not going to work well, or vice versa. So Empower Network is not a tool for everybody, but it is a tool for those who work well with that tool. And the only way to find out is, you know, try it, give it a fair chance, and if it works for you, great, and if not, you know, drop it like a hot potato. But, you know, people are like, oh, Empower Network screwed me, or this doesn't work.
Well, see, this is a thing. There's never been a black and white 100%, because it can serve a group of people, but then other people can grow out of it, and like you said, they'll worship tool instead of, like, oh, this is a tool.
Another example, have you ever heard of Carlton Sheets' real estate program, No Money Down Real Estate? Like, the infomercials have been out there forever. But, you know, people have complained about that. And, you know, it's like, oh, the no money down, you know, system and blah, blah, blah. And it's like, okay, here's his system summarized in a few short words, for sale by owner. The whole system teaches you to work on that grassroots level of, you know, the real estate market. And it requires a passion for that. It requires a passion for dealing with people and being social and working that sort of the system. So it's not going to be everybody's cup of tea. But people put it on a pedestal, and then they get pissed off when it's not their passion, and they blame the course.
Well, it's a reflection again of just, here is a tool for a certain type of person, but it doesn't resonate, and people will get upset if it doesn't resonate, and then they'll have their opinion. But again, our responsibility is personal.
Well, responsibility is just your...
Right, and that circles me back to what I was saying, was just the fact that, like, it's really important for the individual to understand what works best for them. You know, some people really like the rigid, structured, routine way of doing things, like social media, for instance. They really love focusing on the leads and how they're converting and blah, 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 blah. And then there's some people who are very intuitive and natural and fluid with it, and they're just about creating the connections and creating the relationships. And, you know, it's a much more organic process that you can't really quantify or put stats on.
It's like how you quantify PR, basically. It's like, how do you quantify becoming a friend? Like, what are if people love systems, and we like to know, that's how our brains work. It's like, if I say hello to this person and then they say hello back, and then I respond with how are you with my tone of voice at this level, then they will have this response, because we like to know what will happen and we want to control things. And with human beings, you don't know necessarily what you can control and what you cannot. So when people say, I want 1,000 followers on social media, that's saying, like, I want to get 1,000 friends today. And it's a long-term game. It's an organic game where it's like, I want to get sales right away. You can, but you've got to be in an established voice. You've got to be in a group party. People know you already as you are the writer of, I don't know, how to crochet things or something, you know? And it's like, you are the go-to crochet author and teacher, and everyone knows you as that. So with social and in real life, because social media is just another paradigm online with real actual social networking in neat space, it's like trying to teach somebody how to network or how to become friends with somebody. And I think for social media managers and people like that, they have, it's an intuitive thing. It's like, I love to attract friends and I love to make new friends, and if you don't like to, and this is what makes me upset, is like, I want to use social media to just get sales. It's like, then you're never going to succeed at social media.
How do I get 10,000 sales right now? I don't know. How many salts are in the soup? Count them.
Because there's a way, there's a system to do that, and, you know, there's ways of doing that, but it's PR. It's how are people seeing you? Do they know you? Do they like you? Do they trust you enough to give you their money so that you could solve a problem for them? But I mean, that's a whole other conversation for another day. But, you know, it's like quantifying social relationships, which me as a woman and in my female energy speaking right now just feels inauthentic. Because the logical masculine side of me says, I have a complete system that I know how I can get sales by having conversations with people, because I know how to do that, and I've practiced it, and I've done tests in that, but I don't want to use that and give that just to anyone. I don't think anyone immediately is just worthy of that, you know, so I'm coming from my female side right now.
I think another common problem is when people look at the word responsibility, they think that responsibility is some task, some process that is going to be given to them by a benevolent authority when they reach a certain rite of passage, and they will be given these tasks, this responsibility. Here's what responsibility actually is. It's your ability to respond. Ability. That's why they call it taking responsibility, because no one's going to give it to you. If you wait for someone to give you responsibility, you will be waiting until hell freezes over and the devil's giving sleigh rides, because no one's ever going to give you responsibility. That's what they call it, taking responsibility. I have a PSEC episode on that called Let's Take Responsibility, your ability to respond. If you sit there going, I want my Obama cell phone and my food stamps and my politically correct but heard everybody telling me what to do so I could sit here and expect those people to do this for me and blame these people for what's not being done, and I could sit here and all curled up, not responding to anybody or anything. You're not going to get anywhere with that, sorry.
Well, I love that you bring that up because I think the current system that the current system of education is not setting us up for personal responsibility because it's very safe, and being uncomfortable, people want to keep each other safe from being uncomfortable. So in school, the worst thing that could ever happen is to fail, and that is uncomfortable because everyone will judge you in that way. But as entrepreneurs, we know we learn the most by failing because it is uncomfortable, and we react, or not react, we take responsibility for that. So in school, you don't have to take responsibility for that. The only thing you are responsible for
school, though,
is... What was that?
Nobody fails school, though. School fails them. You ever notice school is not designed to go, okay, let's see what you're good at and hone in on those skills. They're
because
like...
Because they'll be focusing instead of on the collective industrial, which was, that's what the school system was for, was like setting us up for the industrial revolution.
The Prussian system. Our current model is based on the Prussian system,
which
is the system that Hitler used to indoctrinate Germany to take power and kill 6 million Jews, and that's the Prussian system.
Because how else could you control a big country without, you know, without having a system in that way, because if everybody thought for themselves, then who would be in control?
Exactly.
How could you then have some kind of not anarchy?
Well, actually, anarchy just means a system without rulers. It doesn't mean a system without rules. As a matter of fact, what people think anarchy means, statism actually means that. What they're looking to avoid with anarchy, they actually already have with statism.
Yeah, but it's like this is where I understand the perspective of, because I was always about, I was the one that skipped college and was like, boo, college all the time, when that was my perspective, and now I understand where I was coming from. And I saw that that was a system on a grand level, on a macro level, that was keeping people in control and did the best for that time. But now, because even I remember in high school, we saw a video that said, by the time we graduate, the whole world is going to be completely different, so we're sending up students for a world that doesn't exist yet.
Exactly. You know, I've got a synonym for the Prussian educational system, Stockholm Syndrome.
That's a good one.
There you go.
But it's like, change is uncomfortable, and to change on a macro level requires the same language and the same communication method. And change, as we know, on a macro level takes time. I just came back from Romania, where there was a radical change after revolution, and people are still dealing with the ramifications of that because the West had all these bourgeoisie educated, you know, they've already gone through that, and they had the revolutions. And they brought that to the West, and they forced it to the West because they saw the possibility of what that could be. But they were still in a feudal system. They were still on a level like that. So you bring in a revolution that was past bourgeoisie, where people didn't experience that. They weren't at the level yet consciously as a whole collective.
You gotta have a revolution of the mind before you can have the body. Otherwise, you're just going to revolve. You're going to repeat the same thing, cycles. And
this is why we study history, so we don't repeat it. But unfortunately, we're still not looking at the individual to take responsibility as an individual for our own consciousness and our mind, and then having the same language that we could communicate that efficiently with other people.
And that's why the 14th Amendment defines involuntary servitude and voluntary servitude, because you needed those two in there so that they could make 14th Amendment slaves of us all, incorporate the United States as a for-profit corporation under which we are all legal employees that have to obey the crybaby-in-chief.
Well, Well, this is the argument, because I've been mulling this over in my head, is like, is it better, like, on the micro scale, because that is all we can do right now, how does that reflect on a macro scale? Because I want to have, for example, I work with a team of people, and if we do not have the same language and the same communication styles established at the very beginning, then some people will feel like they're being used. Some people will feel like they don't communicate the same way, and then anger happens, and then negative emotions happen. So I think on a big, big level, we've built something on a micro scale, like from the micro consciousness, and that's our reality that we have today. And now what happens, and I think our generation has to take responsibility for, is our own consciousness and build macro levels of that consciousness for our corporations or for our businesses or for our countries, because that's all just the same representation.
I think the big interference there is the poor little me, I'm nothing, I'm incapable attitude.
Well, that's personal responsibility, where each individual has to take that. So where does that start? How do we start that conversation?
Because clear communication is the key to solving problems, but we're not going to communicate clearly if we're sitting here thinking, I can't, I have no skill, I have no talent, I have no capability.
So what do we do?
Anything.
We empower them.
All we can do is you know, act as an observable and, you know, example of the change we want to create, because then we're defying everybody's belief systems. Become the pink elephant flying down the street that's not supposed to exist, and then people look at that and the logical mind goes, I'm seeing that, but their belief systems say that can't be, so then they have to reevaluate their own paradigm.
Yeah.
Well, that's how it works, though. I mean, I did that with my own family. You know, I trained my family on how to communicate differently and how to actually have healthy relationships with each other just by me changing and me being different. And that's what we're saying about, you know, be the change you want to see in the world. You know, you start modeling personal responsibility and people are like, oh, well, that was easier. Like, and even in my marriage, you know, with Paul, I have a great level of personal responsibility. Whenever I have an emotional reaction to something, I'm very clear. I talk about it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, at the beginning, he wasn't a very good communicator about feelings. And now, 2 years into it, we're like, we talk about it. And, you know, it dissolves tension immediately, because that is the level I think humans are able to communicate at. And it's, we just have not had very good models.
Yes.
Because there's just been so much ego and competition and bullshit, honestly, quite frankly, just a bunch of bullshit and trauma. We've all been acting out of our wounding.
Yeah.
So when you're able to rise up out of that as a personal person, like as an individual, then you can start responding to other people in new ways. Like Dave, for instance, is my best friend, and he's been my best friend for like 4 years, and we have clashed and hit heads and, you know, everything. It's just been so wonderful as a lesson, a crash course, in authentic communication.
You
and that has helped me in my entire life.
You want to tell her about the sheet barrier?
Yeah, I went and visited him in Chicago, and I didn't know how to explain how I was feeling. And, like, I literally, he had to put up a sheet because I was so uncomfortable with my emotions and all of the angst that was inside of me, like, back in, I don't know, 2013.
Mm-hmm.
And he had to put up a sheet barrier because I was, like, I couldn't stand being in the same room.
That was a beautiful way of using a tool to, when you feel like the chaos is coming, the emotional, you know, stuff is coming up, we use tools. Like how Dave said, we didn't worship the tool, but it was something we used to move forward and progress consciousness so we could communicate at the same level.
It was like, I don't have my space, I don't have my space. I'm like, oh, really? Here. I divided the room with a frickin' sheet. I strung up a frickin' line, and I took two sheets, so it's like open, close, like a curtain.
Yes.
I'm like, I'll use my laptop over there. You can use this computer here. Here's your little grassroots homegrown cubicle. Now you have your space. And she was totally floored, like, oh, crap, now I have nothing to shake my fist at and feel justified. I refer to that as the problem is that there is no problem. It's ironic that society has been trained that you know, we are told that the word problem and equation are synonyms, and we're told that everything in life is an equation to deal with or a problem to deal with. So when something isn't happening that we're expecting to happen, we think that's a problem. So when we define life as a never-ending series of problems, and then suddenly the problems are gone, then it becomes, we panic, because now the problem is that there is no problem. And yeah. We don't know how to deal with that. Oh my God, there's no problem! Ah! I made a funny graphic about that a long time ago, like a fake Windows error message graphic, and it said, you know, something, I'll look it up later and give it to you later, but it said something to the effect of, you know, Microsoft Windows error generation system, you know, the error detection system has noticed that there are no errors to detect, and it says, you know, please correct the problem, and it gives a list of suggestions like install adware or malware, swipe your hard drive with a magnet, you know, all these other things, but, you know, it's again, it's like, error, there are no errors.
On that same note, I want to talk about that because we're talking about, you know, authenticity and success, right? So I think that one of the funny things about, you know, being on this personal path of evolution and growing as people is we realize, like, once we get to that point of realizing that the problem is there is no problem, and we start having, like, what Dave likes to call abundance freakouts and... you know, abundance overwhelm, and you're just, abundance like, shock. So frustrated and angry. Abundance shock, yeah. You're so frustrated and angry, even though there's absolutely nothing wrong.
Yeah.
I'm sure you've probably had plenty of that. Like, I know that I had that when I was traveling, and I was just, like, looking at my surroundings and feeling like, holy shit, I'm here, but, like, why do I feel so anxious and upset?
Yes.
Like, the whole, like, addicted to misery.
Every time I'm traveling and, like, I'm going to places that I'm dreaming about going to, then I'm like, am I enjoying myself all the way? Like, no, this is supposed to be happening like this, but no, this is like this. It's like, why can't I enjoy myself? Okay, brain, shut up. Let me just enjoy, and then you can let me enjoy.
It's because you developed an allergy to appreciation.
Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm. It's so interesting, though, how we do that.
I'm fiending, goddamn, where's my heroin?
Right, and then we create the problems, or we create the illusion of problems, like, by fighting or picking fights. Like, that's one of my favorite abundance shock maneuvers, is, like, to pick a fight with Paul. Like, or Paul, or Dave. Like, just the other day, we were on a Google Hangout, and, like,
fuck you, Dave! Why? Just because you're an asshole. Shut up!
Right, and, like, I shut off the Google Hangout. Because I was, like, so frustrated. I was like, I can't deal with this. Like, what is going on? Why am I doing this crap?
Yes, yes. And I think the same thing was, like, when we're, like, go, 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 move forward all the time. And then we don't celebrate our successes. And even just for real, though, I saw this, when was it? Just that you are alive is one of the biggest amazing successes. Ever. Like, you were that one little sperm that won to the egg, and you were a success. Like,
I love that, yeah.
If you don't celebrate that, if you do not know how to celebrate just that, then you don't know how to celebrate any other accomplishment that you have.
I was about to ask you, Isabelle, did you know that there's a biological component to this? And right as I was thinking that, you're talking about sperm.
I'm sure there is. It's all connected. All the systems are connected.
Yeah, check it out. Here's what most people don't know. It's really interesting. This is some helpful knowledge. We have this thing called a hypothalamus that has more pharmaceuticals than your local Walgreens or CVS. Mm-hmm. And because we're running an electrical central nervous system, everything is frequency-based. So your emotions are frequency-based. Like how, you know, your keyboard communicates with your computer to know what to pop up on the screen, right? So with each of those frequencies, emotions have a frequency, and that hypothalamus receives that signal, and so that you can literally feel emotion in the body. There is a neural peptide for each and every emotion that you've ever had and didn't even know you're capable of freaking feeling. There's a neural peptide for that, and there's receptors in the cells. Well, we live in a society that is pumping us with 24/7 fear, so we've got this stress hormone always pumping through us, and stress hormone is so corrosive that they actually use artificial stress hormone in anti-organ rejection medication, because if you get a new organ, the body attacks it as a foreign organism, and stress hormone shuts down your immune system. Gee, and people are wondering why they're sick. Corrosive. But any of those chemicals that you have pumping through your system long enough, your cells start to get addicted to it. So when all of a sudden you clear out all these problems in your life, right, that you're not getting that stimulus, you're not having that experience for your central nervous system to send that energy up to the hypothalamus and say, hey, release that chemical I'm addicted to. Yeah. So now your cells are going through withdrawal. It's just like heroin or anything like that. So you're like, you're feeding for your misery crack, literally. So it's like, how am I going to get my fix? Oh, create drama.
Yes.
Then the hypothalamus will fire off what I need, and then my cells will be happy. While they're being destroyed by the corrosive freaking stress hormone.
Mm.
Stress hormones are not meant to pump through you constantly. They're meant to be there for like 15 seconds so you can avoid becoming roadkill from that oncoming truck as you freaking move. Mm. That's what the stress hormone is there for, to give you a quick kick in the ass. It's not like to have an IV drip of it going through you all your life.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yep.
Yep. All of us, I feel, have dealt with that in some way, shape, or form. I mean, I definitely had, like, autoimmune issues and, like, crazy fibromyalgia and, like chronic fatigue and, like, all that bullshit.
All of it.
Like, I was just, like, drenched in it for my entire life. And so, you know, as I was moving out of that, you know, and my friendship with Dave was really a pivotal point for that, and, you know, I would rage and freak out, and it was just, like, seriously, somebody coming off, like, you know, heroin, like going to the methadone clinic, like, you know, please, I need my fix.
Yes, yeah. And it's,
speaking of drugs, though, and I'm only going to say this because I know somebody's going to ask, because somebody always asks or mentions it. This is tobacco, not weed. I wish it was weed. I wish it was legal here. But no, this is tobacco. Because, you know, somebody, if I don't say it, somebody makes the observation, dude, he's got a pipe. He must be smoking a reefer, yeah. No, sorry, it's tobacco. Unfortunately. As much as I wish it, I admit that I wish it was something else, but sadly, it's not. I'm only saying it because I know somebody's going to be like, oh, dude, pipe. Yeah, man. It always happens if I don't mention it. It always freaking happens.
Well, guys.
You know what was one of the distinctions on my last trip? I was doing some inner work with a friend, and one of the stories that I kept having with me for all of the work I was doing, and it was manifesting in my life in holding me back from evolving forward, was I always had to prove and explain myself to others instead of just being.
Mm-hmm.
The life is so easy, and we make it so hard. And for every little thing that I would do, even working with clients or something, like, it was completely clear in my mind that this is what I'm doing, and I didn't have the right words because we were completely communicating on different frequencies, and words like, if I said chair, they understood sofa, because that's what happens, that's how we communicate when we're not on the same frequency. Then they would be like,
yeah, I totally can.
So then afterwards, when I got results at a certain level and it wasn't the expectation met from that one client, because I didn't get a million likes overnight, because I know how social media works, and I said, it's a long-term game, then anger would happen and this would happen. And then I realized, you know what? I don't have to explain myself because I explained how this works.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't have to prove that I am worthy of business with you or friendship or relationship or whatever. And it's not in a negative way, like, you are wrong and you don't have any idea how this works. Like, that's why you hired me, because I'm the expert at this, you know.
But, oh, I used to have a client like that. He turned into a heap.
But that's the thing, though. Realizing the story, putting light and awareness on it, empowered me to stand up for my worth, not just in business, not just in relationships, but as a human being.
Yep.
worthy to serve others, you know, and I didn't, and I would be the same, I would always be like, oh, I have to say this because I have to cover my butt here, and I have to do this here, this here. This is why I'm like, okay, this is why lawyers exist, so they can cover our butts, and that's what their strengths are, and that's what their light is for the world, so that they can communicate that, you know. But for me, it's, I didn't have to explain myself anymore. And then I started bringing in people in my life and clients into my life that they're like, yes, here, take it on. I completely trust you with this. And I was like, I completely trust you with this. And we were on the same frequency, and chair meant chair. And it was a beautiful thing. It was definitely a transformation for me that manifested in my reality outside. I mean, the story still comes up because, you know, our neural pathways have to, it takes a little while for that stuff to change. But it's definitely manifested as soon as I put awareness on that story of like, oh, I don't have to have a long explanation for why I said what I said. If you have a question, I will answer it. But otherwise, I don't have to.
I think that I have dealt with that one so much.
Yeah.
Because I ping pong around from like what to call myself. Healer, coach, counselor, blah, blah, therapist. Like, I get it all because people... Like I'm similar to your friend Camille, like in the sense that I do a lot of inner work with people and I help them deconstruct their stories and, you know, have those breakthroughs. Like that's really what I do. That's the end, the long and short of it. A lot of people, they want to put me into the boxes of the terminology of coach or therapist or, oh, you didn't go to college, so therefore you can't help me, or, oh, like why am I paying you this much money? Like if you are not licensed or whatever. Like I'm just like, holy shit, you guys! Like,
my last.
You care? I am helping you.
Yes. My last really jerky, judgmental client like that was in 2010, and I'm actually very thankful to him, because him kind of constantly putting the screws to me, you know, inspired me to, you know, take that personal responsibility. And it's like, He would always just be, like, scrutinizing everything. You know, he had me as a consultant for his business, and I would consult. He's like, oh, Dave, you're such a know-it-all, blah, blah, blah. And it's like, I'm just telling you how this stuff works. And so, like, you know, me taking responsibility finally started, like, it's like the first thing I did, I replied with him, yes, not only do I know it all, I'm Jesus fucking Christ. I am God as far as you're concerned. And until you know as much about this shit as I do, then you shut the fuck up. And he's like, you know, he took a step back. He still kept giving me some attitude about things, though, but it's like, and one time, he was going to do this thing that I totally know would fail. He was going to put, like, $2,000 into buying advertisement, and he had no plan, no strategy, no nothing. I'm like, dude, you cannot throw shit to the wind and expect to rain money. No. And so the inevitable happened, and he got mad at me for calling him on it, you know, before it happened. And then, you know, there was one time he was going on a tirade, like, you know, oh, well, why aren't you rolling in the money? Why don't you have a storefront like I do? And blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, because arrogant fucking assholes like you never fucking listen to me. That is fucking why. You know, and he's like, whoa. And the big thing that really, really got me to the point of saying, okay, I'm not working for you anymore, is like, you know, in 2010, my girlfriend at the time, and this guy owned a jewelry store, still does as far as I know, she, you know, she bought like $200 worth of stuff from him, right? And then even with that, then after that, I won't get into the whole story, but she did something nice for him. And he got so offended by it and was totally just like, you know, dissing on her. And it's like, I'm like, oh my God, it's like, you know what? She just spent $200 with you and she's my girl and you're dissing on her like that. Do I really want to work for somebody like you? Let's see. No. Fuck you. I'm out. I never looked back. And I think if I had continued to work with him, I would not have made a lot of the successes that I've made since then, because he would have kept me trapped in that, you know, victim mentality of always having to fight clients. And I, you know, he was just like my escape from that. Like, all right, I'm giving you the bird, and I'm walking, and it was just so liberating. And from that point forward, you know, it's like after that, you know, my relationship with the girl didn't work out, but I learned from that. I learned a big important lesson. We're all a cooperative component in our circumstances. Holy shit, no fault, no blame. We're all a cooperative component. And once I realized that, it's like I was then compatible with aligning with being able to explore my new knowledge. And so then came Katerina to help me do that, like within a couple of months, bam, I meet Katerina, and fast forward, and here we are. So she's taught me a lot. I'm very thankful to her for that.
Yeah, it's a collaborative and cooperative thing, because we have blind spots that we are unaware of, and when we consciously ask friends and people that we value that are at the same frequency or can communicate in the same way we do, then I'm like, I value your thoughts on this, and I could see that that's a blind spot of mine, or not a strength of mine. Who has that strength that could complement me?
Even the assholes and the trolls are only reflecting to us things that we're in denial of and refusing to face inside of ourselves. So, like, when we see them as, like, the proverbial error message coming up on the computer screen, and we take that opportunity to face whatever that reflection is trying to tell us, then we can actually be thankful. Like, I am thankful for these globalist psychopathic scumfucks who are showing us the error of the humanity and giving us an opportunity to do the right thing. But Dave, how can genocide be a good thing? Gee, I don't know, maybe it's giving us the opportunity to go, you know, maybe we shouldn't do genocide anymore. So there's that realization.
Katerina has a thing.
I have a thing. Do you know all those people, like myself included, who were really afraid of visibility and like putting themselves out there and like, you know, attracting trolls or whatever, getting people who were mean and hateful or whatever?
That reminds me.
You know, all those people.
Earlier, but I'll wait. Yes, go ahead. Yes, I know. Totally. Yes. Right there with you.
So since those people are reflecting back to us the stuff that we're denying about ourselves and in denial about, we're really just afraid of ourselves. Holy crap.
Yeah. Like, you know.
Whoa, brain!
This is like the we're always consciously creating our reality, and I love that you said that, because once you realize that you can create your own reality, then you can choose whatever game you want to play in life, and that's why you can choose the character you want to be in this, because when you're coming from that realization of you are the possibility of being whatever you want to be, that is your authentic self, and then your strengths, the curiosities and inclinations are what make you unique from all these other human beings around you. You are free mentally to do whatever you want.
I usually don't use the term we are creating our own reality, because people tend to find a way to still twist that.
Well, see, but that's the thing, is like we're speaking all of us at the same frequency of creating our reality is our conscious thinking. As if I could explain what that means for people.
Oh, I know, but I'm saying, you know, people tend to twist that into, I'm creating my reality because the universe is letting me, so I still have my cosmic babysitter here. I feel like to put
that's not taking responsibility.
Yeah. And people, because of that mindset, see, to me, when I think of things like creating our own reality, that's like, okay, let's actually learn the metaphysics and the quantum physics and actually have that understanding of the science of how that works.
Yep.
So we can take those tools and apply it, whereas too many people think, oh, I create my reality, so if I think of a car is just going to appear out of nowhere. And you know, that's delusional, because the universe presents to you opportunity to do what you need to do to get that car. It's not Santa Claus. It's not a babysitter. People still view it as like a babysitter. If I think car, babysitter's going to get me the toy car.
But see, this is how people use God as well, because they say, if I pray to God for peace and for wealth and for this, then
God rained down on me.
Yes, and then all these opportunities will come to you, and you're just saying, no, I'm waiting for God to provide. I'm waiting for God to provide. It's like God is like, hey, here you go. Here's a gold on a silver platter opportunity for you, but you don't want to take it. You were asking me for this, but you're not willing to receive.
The funny thing is that we are always asking all the time, so we are always the prayer, but we're not conscious of what we're asking for, because our core belief systems is the asking. So deep down, when we say, oh, we believe misery and suffering is the only real reality, God, the universe, whatever, is like, okay, here you go. There you go. People think it's only manifesting when their ego approves of it. No, the quantum mirror does not take coffee breaks. Everything is a freaking mirror. What you put out, you put back. So when you really think, yep, reality is misery and suffering and that's it, then that's what's brought to you. I prefer to look at it as, yeah, does misery and suffering exist? Yeah. Is that, like, the only reality? No, there's all these realities, like, in parallel to each other. And, you know, if we can see that they're all in parallel, that life is reality is a cake, not a light switch, it's not on or off. You've got a configuration of ingredients creating the cake. I mean, do you cook? Do you bake? If so, then you know that the slightest change of ingredients creates a whole different cake. Yes. Because it's a configuration of interactive components. I mean, there's little difference between cake and bread on the ingredients level, but the end result expression is hugely different. So that's why I say reality is a cake, not a light switch. People say
we're all just different cakes, and you can choose what ingredients you want to put in your cake and what that looks like in your reality, and then what other kind of cakes you want to have at the party.
Yeah. The whole it's either on or it's off. It's either this or it's that. To me, it's like saying, you know, the right side of your body can only exist if it annihilates the left side of your body, or, you know, vice versa.
Think about how weird people would look walking around.
Yeah, no kidding. It's like you can't. I'm sorry. It's not.
Yes.
So what I was going to say before, one of the ironies that I have faced is that, okay, it's not that I have a hard time teaching people how to make money using YouTube and social media and stuff like that. I have a hard time getting people to see that they're capable. Here, look at these. Here, look at these. I'll show you. No, it's not. I'm poor little me. I'm not capable of anything. Blah blah blah. Or even.
But see, though, that is again another reflection on us.
Mm-hmm.
Because we are bringing in those people. Like, no, this is hard. And when we drop that ourselves, then we drop those kinds of people from coming into the life that we have for, like, I can see that this is possible, or you are that transformational point for that person.
Or what's even worse, and I think we've all experienced this, is when those people finally get to the point of, wow, I can be successful, then it's like they're afraid of their success more than their failure.
Yes.
You never taught me how to deal with success. People think that comfort or comfort zone is, oh, it's nice, it feels good. No, comfort zone means what you are used to, what you are familiar with, what you know how to navigate. Mm-hmm. And people are very comfortable and familiar with navigating being slaves to the psychopathic babysitters we put in power. They are familiar with suffering and misery and judgment and all that. That is their comfort zone. They are not comfortable with appreciation and good things and success and all that. That's not in their comfort.
Yes.
They're not familiar with it. They don't know how to navigate it. And we're taught new is scary, new is dangerous, different is bad, avoid that, shun that. So all the things that we want, we view as the enemy.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're used to what we're used to. We're comfortable with our suffering. Even the Buddha pointed it out.
Yes.
People always misunderstand the Buddha. When he sat under the tree and went, there is suffering. It's not like, it's always taken out of context. It's not like, there is suffering. Well, no shit, Sherlock, there's suffering. What he was saying is that we are addicted to suffering. That was his expression. Like, oh my God, we're on crack here, guys.
Yeah, like the stress hormone, like you said. It's addicted to the stress hormone and suffering. But I think also in Western culture, we have it's a little bit different than Eastern, where you have to sacrifice everything you can for success. You have to experience so much suffering before you can succeed.
We actually have that here in a different form. We call it political correctness. You have to abide by this, 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 and this at your personal expense and kiss all this ass here and appease all these people here and get all this approval from all the professionals up here. You have to suffer and sacrifice under these policies and protocols and political correctness in order to obtain your enlightenment and success to be able to blah, blah, blah. No, we totally have that in the Western world. It's just expressed very differently and far more pathologically and psychotically. And apathetically, but we totally have that here.
I would like to know on the individual consciousness, where did that all stem from? Because I could see the cultural, like, story of where that came from Western Europe, and then I can also see now that it's a mix, because America really is a mix of all these other cultures, and nobody can get along. And
I can tell you simply, it's a huge... It's one core paradigm, honest to God. One core human paradigm. Think of it as like a T-shirt. Mm-hmm. And because humans are so creative, we put all these different pictures on the same T-shirt, all these different logos, but we've forgotten that it's a T-shirt, and we become so fixated on the picture that we think the picture that the picture is all that's there. We don't realize that it's a picture on a T-shirt. So instead of saying, oh, there's a T-shirt with a picture of an elephant, we say, that's an elephant. And here's another T-shirt with a picture of a bird. There's a bird.
That's an eagle. So
then a debate happens. Birds are different than elephants. They're different. They're two different complete things. And we forget, no, it's all the same, because it's not really a bird. It's not really an elephant. It's the same T-shirt, the same core paradigm, mm-hmm. that we have used our creativity to paint these illusions over so we can pretend that it's two different things, so then they can fight.
Mm-hmm. But I think then the game that we're playing, because once you realize that this all is an illusion, and it's coming from this cultural, psychological... masculine, feminine, all whatever stories are manifesting this in our macro reality.
The word illusion is another problem. People think illusion means fake or not real. That's not what it means. Illusion means that we have a misunderstanding of how something actually works.
Yep.
Like David Copperfield's up on stage making things disappear. Oh, he's not really doing that. Yes, he is really making things disappear. But you're making an assumption about how he's doing it. Well, it only counts as disappearing if he's doing it this one way. Yep. Otherwise, it's fake. It's like, no, it's not fake. He's really making it disappear. Mm-hmm. You're just making an assumption about how. He might be using mirrors and light and shadow to make it disappear. Because he's not claiming that he's removing it from reality. He's just making it disappear. It's visual. You can't see it. It's gone.
Yes.
But then we have a paradigm, well, it only counts as disappearing if we teleport it to dimension X. Otherwise, is disappearing. It's like, look, can you see it? No, then it fucking disappeared, okay? You're just being a control freak and saying what counts as disappearing.
Yes.
That's
and this is why I think that us raising consciousness is our responsibility, using these tools and assumptions that our macro reality is to raise consciousness. Like, for all of the stories I tell, because really, they're all just stories, brands are stories, and we use color psychology and we use words to convince and persuade. We have the power to, you know, raise consciousness in a way that might be a little bit different than what's been going on right now. Like, I hate to play by the rules.
Right.
And there's the advice all the time, like, break the rules, break the rules. And I'm like, yes. Break the rules.
The late great Dave Corso said, play their game, but play it your way.
Exactly. Exactly. So we know that that's the construct right now. So if we want change or if we want transformation on a global level, then we got to play the game, but with our way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because people forget that the control freaks in power, they are more addicted to sameness than they've made us. They become slaves to the slaves, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And I always ask people, because people are like, I want to change the world, but it's so hard. I'm like, look, if you want to change all the fish in the ocean, what's the easiest way to do it? Catching it out an individual fish at a time or changing the ocean? Mm-hmm. What's the easiest way? So if you change the world around the psychopaths, so that the psychopath scumbaggery is no longer compatible with the world, then it doesn't matter what they try to do. It's going to be like they're doing nothing, and they're just going to stand there and cry, why isn't this working anymore? Yes. You can't put Windows 95 on a Commodore 64. It's incompatible. So, you know, make the world around you incompatible with the psychopaths instead of thinking, oh, we got to vote the bum out. No, you can't. Two words. Electoral college. I rest my case. You can't vote the bum out. But you can change the world around the bums so that the bums are no longer compatible with the world around them.
Yes. Yes. And it's a collective.
Mm-hmm.
It's a collective, collaborative, co-creative effort. And, you know, that's how revolutions start. But revolutions always have this thing about them where you are wrong and we are right and we have the absolute 100% answer. And what's hard about this, and I see that too with, what was it, Occupy Wall Street, the whole Occupy movement.
People forget that Hitler was a revolutionary.
Yes, exactly. Like, you can use your story for good, or you could use it for evil. Nobody, do you think that Hitler was like, I know I'm going to be the most evil man in the world? No.
He thought he was doing the work of God.
Exactly.
He thought he was bringing about the end times and the return of Christ. Dude was cool.
Well, see, but did he do his job? He brought the German country together after they were all separated from World War I. And, you know, he reached his goals, because that's the danger with revolutions, where it's like, we are right and you are wrong, and we call these people psychopaths that are in power. But do you think that they believe that they are evil? They believe that they are doing the greater good, but then what is the greater good? Because this is, again, dichotomy, good and bad. When we know it's in that middle, it's just a space.
Yeah, I mean, people complain about all the genocide and all the stuff that's going on, and I'm just like, look. Try to look at it from their point of view. I'm not saying agree with their point of view, but try to look at it from their point of view. And I use this analogy. How many people really feel horrible when they eat a hamburger? We all know where hamburger comes from, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, these psychopaths, they view us the same way as we view chickens and cattle. We are resources to be used.
Yes.
That is their thinking. So we don't think that we are evil, horrible people every time we eat a hamburger, and they don't think they're evil, horrible people every time they drop their bombs and kill a million people in a shot overseas, because they think they're doing good for the planet. They think, oh, well, this group is in the way of this agenda, and this agenda is good for the planet. It's positive for the planet. Mm-hmm. And this evil group of people here, this malfunction in the machine of Earth, well, we're deleting this error. So we're doing something good. We're deleting the error to bring about this positive agenda for the planet. And they don't see it from the perspective of the people they're bombing over here.
Mm-hmm.
To use an old quote, what's chaos for the fly is completely normal for the spider.
Exactly. So that's why when I see that change is possible, I am wary, because I know that I could create a story that would create change. But like you said, with anything that we do, we're going to attract people that resonate with the message and people that don't, because we live in a dichotomy world. That's how our brains work. That's how our reality is, unfortunately.
For now.
So it's very easy to start that, and it could start overnight. So I think I go back again to, what is the best thing that we could do as individuals to change the collective consciousness of the whole planet and our universe for now? I think it's the personal way that we live our lives and transform our consciousness for others around us, because we are all in different communities. And when people say, hey, she doesn't react in this way with this person, like, usually I'd be angry, or I would be very happy if I got this. Like,
the reactions I get is, how in the hell are you so calm? Why are you not like right now?
Yeah.
How are you doing that?
Because emotions aren't a bad thing either, because there's that other extreme where it's like, you can never be angry. You can never.
And I'm just like, well, I'm annoyed. I'm just not letting it co-opt to me like an Anakin Skywalker bitch fit. You gotta love that with Star Wars. It's like, okay, Anakin, make your choice. The beautiful Senator Hottie or the creepy old pedophile? And Anakin's like, pedophile, give me that creepy dick, you know? Like, what? What really? Okay, you got gorgeousness here, creepy old pedophile here. You're gonna... Dude, what's wrong with you?
It goes back to, we believe we need to suffer.
You got Jedi powers in a hottie, and you're gonna take it up the ass with the pedophile guy here. Creepy old nasty prune face. What the fuck is your problem? You know? And Hitler was Anakin Skywalker. He was this cocky, arrogant Jedi on the side of light that got corrupted by Palpatine, although, as the history goes, he got corrupted by the Thula Society, who ironically were run by the very enemies that he was trying to defeat, because Hitler was like one of the first truthers, so to speak. He recognized what we refer to as the Illuminati and how they run it, but he didn't have enough knowledge about it to target the right people. As my dad likes to say, he killed the wrong Jews, you know. So he's manipulated by his very enemy that he didn't know was pulling his strings. So he was just being used as a pawn and a puppet, just like Palpatine used Anakin Skywalker as his puppet to obtain his agenda of the Galactic Empire. Hitler is Anakin Skywalker.
That's the thing. It's like, we can create a story right now that would be revolutionary around the world, but if it's coming from a place of not consciousness, then you know you're going to be a puppet for a grander story that you might not even be aware of.
Yeah.
So that's the thing. I would just play in the playground that is Earth right now and come from a place of consciousness myself as much as I can, with the awareness that I have, and work on that every day.
Where'd you go, Dave?
He disappeared.
No.
I'll be right back.
Ah. That was like such a, like a whoa, like, that was like, a, I don't know, like a mind travel. It was a mind journey. You guys just took me down. I didn't see things like that.
That's, it's like once you, I think, once I figured out that it's just me consciously deciding what I want to do with my life and follow the curiosities naturally, go in those directions, that synchronicity happens and opportunities happen. Like, that's the easy part. And
it is.
You know,
the other part, you know, is letting the stories drop away. We're like, oh, you're too young, or you're too this, or you're too that, or blah, 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 blah. Like, you know, that's all of the battle. That's, like, the battle, you know, the inner fight that happens.
It's all the inner stuff. And I was always of the, like, I would work with intuitive women on, like, virtual assisting stuff. And then I would get so impatient because I was like, we need this, and we want, and you say you want sales, and we need this, and blah, 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 and always move forward, 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 when they were doing everything the right way intuitively, when it's not the right time now, or I'm not feeling this right now, or I'm not ready for that yet. And you cannot force a revolution on somebody that's not ready.
Oh, my God, I have learned that the hard way myself.
You know,
the power of the backside of the Force. Embrace your suffering. Let me stick my lightsaber up your cornhole. You must suffer. We live in a dichotomy world. Execute Order 69.
This is Darth Powder.
Darth Powder.
Darth Powder. Have you ever seen the movie Powder?
No,
with the bald guy who was like, he was just like pure electricity and energy, and he was walking around like being like this really advanced human. But, it was like in the 90s, and so Dave, when he shaves his head and his beard and stuff, like, it, he just looks like Powder. And so then he put on his hoodie one day, which is like, I am Darth Powder. Like,
I am Darth Kangaroo Genitalia. You will buy Lucid Dreaming Tea, which is made by an Australian in Thailand. I'm not kidding. You only knew the power of Lucid Dreaming Tea, made with pure 100% kangaroo cock imported from Australia. If you only knew the power of Lucid Dreaming Tea. No, seriously, our friend Trent makes lucid dreaming tea. I got mine, and he is an Australian living out of Thailand, and he also recently sent some lucid dreaming tea for Katerina and my friend Rich, and at some point in the near
future. You're going to send me it, right?
I'll be shipping that off, yeah. So.
Woo-hoo. Love it. That's awesome.
By the way, I have a question that I wanted to ask you, Isabel. Like, when you move, like, you said you're going to be, like, moving back to Chicago or whatever, like, is that, like, a temporary, like, location?
No. I was going to stay in Paris for longer, but the whole refugee thing that was going on there, it wasn't the great time to stay, because I was just going to get an apartment in Paris.
So you're here for a while.
Yeah, I want to get an apartment in Chicago and an apartment in Paris, and then have those as my home bases.
And do you have, like, you use just a laptop, or do you have a desktop computer, too, or whatever? Or
just what do you, my laptop.
Would you like a desktop computer? I have so much computer hardware here, it's not even funny. I can totally part with some and, you know, hook you up with a machine or whatever if you want.
Oh, thank you.
I've got a massive, I mean, you know.
Do you have Windows machines or Apple machines?
Oh. They're PCs, but I run Linux. I mean, and it's great. I can show you.
You're like my ex-boyfriend.
I absolutely prefer Windows if most have it. I can bite the bullet.
I had my MacBook, and he would always want to be like, I'm going to put Linux on your computer. And
he
I'm like,
does no. that to me. No, I have my Mac, and I love my Mac. And, yes. And he's always just like, Linux, Linux, Linux.
Yes, yes. And I was like, but. I like aesthetics.
Yeah, and, you know, that's another paradigm. Why do you think that Linux has no aesthetics? Linux can literally...
It has.
Literally look and act and do
everything. It doesn't resonate with me, and I like pretty things. Not that Linux isn't pretty, but I like, I love little details, and, like, for every little thing, it has a story and all that.
I love the ergonomics of Mac computers, like the touch keyboard and stuff, like, oh my gosh, like, and also just the mouse pad, the hardware of the Mac is a really good thing.
My question is just simply why you're under the impression that Linux can't do that. That's what I don't get.
No, it's actually, like, the hardware of a touchpad, like this,
like,
thing.
It's the whole user experience.
Okay.
Yeah, it's very different, Dave.
Well, hey, you're under no obligation to accept a free desktop system. If you want to reject that abundance, that's fine. You're right to do so. I'm just offering because I got so much hardware around here. It's not going to kill me.
No, that is appreciated. I fixed my laptop. I might in the near future, maybe.
Don't feel accepted. Don't feel pressured to accept it, Isabel. He does this shit to me sometimes, too.
But I just fixed up my MacBook, and my MacBook is all that I need for right now.
Okay.
But thank you a lot. Yeah.
You see, I can accept thanks but no thanks. Mm-hmm. What I find interesting is when people are like, screw you, how dare you try to give me something?
Oh,
dare you be nice to me? What the fuck?
Well, I had that with the cultural conversations with people that, especially in Europe, they would give you the shirt on your back to, like, just be really, really nice, but it's only a form of just saying it, so people will think that you are very generous. Mm-hmm. And after a while, I was done fighting, saying no, no, no. I was like, thank you, thank you, mm-hmm. thank you. And then, of course, that translated to, like, she's selfish. She's like this. She's like this. And I was like, that was, again, one of those things where I had to drop the story of what others thought and just, if you want something, ask. If you say something, say it and mean it, you know? Like, I have people that come up to me and is like, I have this idea that I'm going to do this and this. And I'm like, okay, so what are you going to do about it? And it's like, well, I don't know. And it's like, I wish that I could be this. And I said, so set a date. When are you going to set? And they're like, what? Me? And I'm like, well, don't tell me the idea if you're not going to do it. Don't waste my time. Because they think your words are your, you know, those are intentions and those are actions that become things. So be careful what comes out of your mouth.
Well, in my view, it's, again, everything is based on those internal core belief systems. So yeah. It doesn't matter if your words are, I'm going to do this, 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 and this. If your core beliefs are, there's no way in hell I can do this.
That's why it's a qualifier for the people that I work with, because when I see they like, I wish I could do this, I dream of doing this, it's a qualifier to see if they are willing to work with me. Because if it scares them when I say, this is a reality that you can make happen, set a date, then I'm like, well, we can't work together because I'm not bringing you kicking and screaming here. You know, this is inner work that has to be done. And then I refer them out to somebody to do the inner work, you know?
People seem to prefer the wanting to the actual receiving, because the wanting is that process of perpetual suffering that they're addicted to. Once they actually receive, then there's no more wanting, and then they don't know what to do with themselves. Oh my god, the problem is there's no more problem. I'm not wanting. Oh, what do I do? Fuck.
Exactly. And I'm like, well, you still want to suffer, so I can give you everything you ever want, but if you're not ready to accept, then I don't want to force it on you. I'm done forcing and convincing people to happiness.
That reminds me, originally a while back, when I started, you know, listening to some of Barbara Marciniak stuff, it's like she said something that was like, and you need to be willing to abandon things. It's a give and a take. If you need to abandon your desire for suffering. And I'm like, at first I'm like, desire for suffering? I don't know anybody who wakes up in the morning and goes, fuck you, I want to suffer today, man. Let's stick a sword through my shoulder, shit, you know. And it's like, at first it didn't make sense to me, because it's like, who wakes up thinking, oh, I want to stick swords through me and get raped in the ass and have my head punched? And it's like, who? But then as I was going through my own paradigms, I'm like, oh, we've got these certain belief systems that say this must be this, this is that, da-da-da, and we're addicted to, I'm right. I'm the right one, and in order to be the right one, I have to be the victim and say that's the enemy over there. Otherwise, if I'm not the victim and they're not the enemy, then I'm not right. And if I'm not right, then my reality is invalidated, and then I don't know who I am, and I risk annihilation of myself, and oh, woe is me, and no, I can't do that. So I have to stick with all these dysfunctions that I identify with, and have said, instead of those are my dysfunctions, I said that is me. I've identified with my disease.
Those are stories. Those are stories that we've accepted and we're living in, instead of like, oh, wait, I can close this book and I can pick up a new book and I can read another one. I can even write my own. Oh, think of that. Like, I could write my own book.
Here's a mind fuck for you. We are nothing. No thing. I am not a computer technician, et cetera, et cetera. That's just a skill set that I happen to possess and own. As a matter of fact, I am not even Dave Kelso. I am the awareness that is having the experience of Dave Kelso in this life. It's almost like thinking that instead of I am using my computer, it's like thinking I am my computer. If you thought you were computer, how much freaking out would you be doing? Oh my god, I need more memory. I'm gonna die. You know, we know we are not literally our computer. So it's like we.
It's
think
so funny because you see it in the language. You'll see that in English where you say I am happy. I am sad. And in French, when they speak and they have an emotion, they say,
I have this.
Yes. And I'm like, oh, how revolutionary is that? And
I knew you were going there. I had a feeling.
They had the language of that. It's like, I have this, not I am.
I have hunger. I have tiredness. Je fatigue.
Yeah. Exactly. Because even I remember learning, and we would say "je suis" something, and then the French professor would say, "No. That's not how you say it. You say j'ai this."
Oui, in your pants, s'il vous plaît, with yourself. I am suffering. I am suffering. I am that I am. I am suffering. I am the lightsaber up my butt. No, you have. You have.
With all the different dynamics and the dichotomies again of this, because I was in Germany and then I was in France, and I saw the differences. Like in Germany, everything is very structured and very gray and very industrial, and everything is on time. The train was always on time. I go in France, the train is late, everything smells like pee and perfume, and you know, and it was wonderful, and I was like, look at this. Because if it was all just like Germany, industrial and gray, imagine the world that we would have. Imagine if it was all like the French, where we don't give a fuck about anything, and we're just like, we have smelly diapers on the metro, but then we also have expensive perfume, and that's a reality, you know? And it's like, then there's no structure, but then there's no romanticism. So we have, like, the systems, but then we also have the, you know, the romantic, wild, creative notions. So mm-hmm. it comes again, and this is, again, masculine and feminine energy. And, I mean, genders come in all different realms.
How about this? Let's view the structured systems mm-hmm. as tools. And then let's use that non-structured individuality with the tool to create new things that don't already exist.
That's what she was about to say.
The tool.
I think that would be wonderful.
Yeah, we become the tools. That's the problem. We try to fit ourselves in these boxes, and we become the tools so much that we even become the tools of the tools. I mean, hey, even President Obama is a total tool. I think the idea of him being able to speak without a teleprompter is just a theory. The jury's still out. It has not been proven that he's actually capable of speech without a teleprompter. I haven't seen it.
He's playing the game that is given to him to have a certain image to play that story. So when you are playing that story, not just any Joe Schmo, well, let's just say this is the story, the Joe Schmo that is dressed a certain way in this paradigm, in this reality, in the American culture, mm-hmm. people will be like, oh, he's not professional. He's not like this. He's not like that. I cannot know and like and trust him. I cannot give him my money. But when you have everything calculated and you use the system and you just have a person that has a certain image, that is how you can start and persuade and manipulate on a grander scale.
Yeah, I forgot if it was Hitler or Machiavelli or who said this, but somebody said, you don't actually have to be an authority to gain power.
Mm-hmm.
You have to act as if you are an authority and everyone will just automatically surrender their power to you. Because you're fitting a certain expression that they believe, oh, their authority, here's my power.
Yes, yes, exactly, exactly. And you know, I did an experiment when I was in Paris. I walked a certain way, and I had, okay, so I before I left, it was 2 days. There was one day where I dressed a certain way, and I carried myself a certain way, and I had a certain mindset. So I had the typical bitch face on, right? It was like, nobody's gonna mess with me, and I'm just walking, and nobody, you know. And it was interesting to see people that usually are like walking in pairs and two, or they're like talking to each other, when I would be walking, when I had the bitch face on, when I carried myself a certain way, they'd walk out of the way. And I would just walk right through.
Mm-hmm.
The second day when I did the experiment, I was just, you know, I didn't care. I dressed a certain way, and I was just like happy-go-lucky me, whatever. People would block my way, and I would be the one that was going around because I wasn't in the mindset of power, like, I don't give a fuck. I'm going to move through, you know? And it was interesting to see just that mindset shift.
Mm-hmm.
That changes the way you carry yourself. That changes the way your reality comes around. And that was just a simple little tweak.
I mean, I know that when, you know, I was looking through your pictures and stuff, looking at you, it's like I was thinking, okay, 1940s meets 2015. I could just imagine you being one of the girls at the companion with Doctor Who going into the TARDIS.
I love that.
That's kind of like, you know, what you seem to present. Like, you know, when I look at a picture of you, I'm just wondering, well, the Doctor can't be too far away here. Where's the TARDIS? Is it in the picture?
Oh my God, you know what's so funny? I had the biggest crush on David Tennant.
You and every other girl on the planet, and every other gay guy on the planet as well, and, you know, anybody who can, yeah. For some reason, he's just got that, you know.
He's, yeah, the coat and the hair, the glasses, like, he's got, like, that sophistication, but then he's got the Converse at the bottom where it's just like, I don't care. No.
Now, for guys like me, it's not, obviously, it's not so much David Tennant, it's like, ooh, Rose.
Oh, yes. Yes, yes. I haven't, you know, Rose I haven't just come like, up with Dr. Rose Who in a like, while.
Rose is just, like, super intelligent, but she's also just, like, that individuated badass. Like, yes, mm-hmm. I'm smart, but I'll fuck you up. Like, you know.
You guys, I have to go at 12, so I just wanted to let you guys
know.
Ditto,
same here.
Oh, so you both got to go at 12. Okay. Yeah. Here's a
fair today. Woohoo!
Here's a question, just out of curiosity. Isabel, do you drive or do you also use public transit?
I drive, but I mainly use public transportation.
Okay, so you do drive, but you have a preference towards public transit.
Mm-hmm. I wish it was better in the suburbs than...
Yeah, like I was saying earlier before the hangout, public transit in the suburbs sucks. It's like, you know, a bus running once every hour or two, and like miss your bus by 60 seconds, you're like...
The infrastructure of public transportation in America, in Europe and in Asia, public transportation is fantastic, and I'm like, America, come on, we can do better. Like, it's not that big of a deal, come on.
I'm from Portland, and we have really good public transportation there, so I was
Portland,
really lucky.
I heard amazing things about public transportation there.
Yeah. TriNet, the Max, it's amazing. You can get anywhere, even in the suburbs.
If they stop embezzling money and putting $500 trillion into war and genocide and actually use it for what we need here, then we might have systems.
It would be wonderful. See where the energy is going, what the priorities are.
And as long as we have the energy of, oh, we're going to allow psychopathic babysitters to bend us over and rape us, then the money's still going to keep going there.
Yeah.
We start taking our power and going, you know, maybe I'll make money on social media and TSU and YouTube and get enough to actually use my creativity and make a template for new different types of structures, and then maybe other people will look at that and go, wow, I like that, and maybe they'll have like $1 billion and they'll write off your idea and they'll really put it into like a more wide-scale use, and it's kind of like, you know, the ripple effect. We're always making...
Do how Iceland did and crowdsource your constitution, public transportation ideas.
There you go. Iceland was just like, hey, we're being run by scumbags. Let's see, there's like 100 of them and 50 million of us. I think we've got some good odds. Let's kick them out.
Well, see, that's the thing. I think because it's one of the good things, but also one of the things that is holding us back in America is everyone's got different cultural conversations. Everyone's got different backgrounds. Everyone's got a bunch of psychological baggage that they're still carrying from all different parts of the world because we're such a melting pot, green salad of ideas that we can't really come together and speak the same language that we could crowdsource our constitution or, I mean, on a smaller scale, I think we can, like, crowdsource for, like, Chicago, for example, public transportation stuff. Like, I know a bunch of people that would definitely be interested in something like that.
You know, I think that there needs to be a transportation system in Chicago that rivals the CTA and competes with them.
Like Lyft and Uber for taxis.
Yeah, well, I don't like Uber and all that because I've got my reasons. They're a ripoff, among other things. But I mean, you know, like somebody that can create these infrastructures that are fair and competitive, not just CTA Part 2. Like, oh, we got two people jacking us up the ass now. No, we've already got Chicago's traveling assholes. We don't need Part 2 of that. You know, it would be nice to have, you know, a competing infrastructure that's fairly priced and, you know, isn't jerking us around. And so then the CTA will either have to change themselves to get and become more benevolent or go out of business. Just like how Zuckerberg is afraid of Sebastian Zubcheck. Like, oh my God, Sebastian has this system that has economic integrity, whereas I'm being a scumbag. So it's like, oh shit, what if his idea catches on? Then I'm in trouble if the world changes around me to be more like his model. How am I going to survive in that? And that's, you know, Zuckerberg's dilemma.
Yep. That's his personal responsibility stuff.
Yeah. So I think, and the more...
Do you guys ever watch that movie, The Social Network?
You know, I did.
No.
I thought he was portrayed so creepily in that movie.
Yeah, yeah. And you know what? I read recently... an article about how it is to work at Facebook, and really because it was just an idea, really an accident that it grew up into something so big because it was organic. The people mm-hmm. saw the need for it and it was organically grown, but then it grew so fast that the infrastructure and the system wasn't there So now it's really, it's building as the train is coming, you know? Yeah. And it's very possible to do that, but on a grand scale, it's really stressful to like, ah, the train is coming, and we're still putting down the tracks, and that's where the Facebook ad idea came later. And then that's where was it Sheryl Sandberg, the COO? So she came from somewhere else, and she was already experienced in a different way of thinking, so yeah, I could definitely empathize with the way that things are going with him, like building while you're doing. He's just following the advice of what has been already done before, and he sees that that's what works, and now that he sees this other guy bringing in a completely different model, because he already built the train tracks, because he was inspired by Facebook and the way that things were going, he's like, well, this guy has his shit together a little bit more than I do, so I think that I could lose money maybe by, you know, doing this. So I could definitely see the his perspective.
Another thing they do, the way they share the revenue, is that when people sign up to TSU, people sign up under you. So you could, you know, see all
the referral, yep,
under you and so on. And basically you get a percentage of, you know, as a result of, you know, them posting content. But it's not like pyramid schemey. They're basically dividing the dollar into five levels. The buck literally does stop there. It doesn't go forever. But so basically, the more you post content and stuff, the more you can make, the more followers and stuff. But also, the more people you have under you and the more they're doing the same, then the more you make, the more they make, so on and so forth. Because it is really a cooperative, collaborative sort of thing. So instead of the idea of, oh, my friend's on this network, but I can't help them because they're my competition. Now it's the idea of, oh, helping them helps me. I can share, I can be generous, I can be benevolent. We could work together because now it's cooperative. It's not,
competitive.
And this scares the shit out of Zuckerberg. So also
he came into the paradigm of competition, and when you're playing the game that you are in this paradigm, competition is success, where cooperation is something that is completely foreign, or maybe the stuff that you don't know. And it can't be, it wasn't tested, it wasn't seen as successful in the traditional sense, then he's thinking, I can't change now, I'm already in too deep. Like, all of a sudden, to pivot everything, I already have 1,000 people under me, and then I tell them I'm going to stop. It's like, wow!
now, if you wanted to sign up under me under this and check out TSU and see if it's something that could work for you, I'm going to give you the link in this chat because, again, Facebook has it cock-locked, so if I tried to message you on Facebook with the link, it wouldn't work, but it's for everybody watching. It's www.tsu.co/paradigmshiftdocs, which is D-O-C-S, the number 4 and the letter U. So I just gave you guys, you know, that link in the chat there. So you can sign up under that. Katerina is already on TSU, so she already knows my link, and I've been sharing her posts like crazy. I challenge her to post one post a day because she's had these social networking blocks and stuff, and I'm like, come on, Katerina, 5 seconds, once every 24 hours. Watch how easy it is to grow more of a following. Just 5 seconds out of 24 hours, because everybody on TSU is nice. I have not experienced any assholes. I just experienced everybody sharing each other's stuff and going, that's nice and that's cool and I like this and thank you. I've not run into any dickheads, so it's a really cool system because, like you're saying about energy, when you build a platform on that energy of cooperation, you're going to draw to you those more cooperative people, and people who are not aligned with that are going to look at that and get a bad vibe and go, no, I don't want to go there. So you're only going to have that like-minded, you know, base. And so my experiences on TSU have been wonderful. Everybody's been completely freaking nice, unlike Facebook. So
well, Facebook has a bigger pie because it's a more accurate representation now of the whole world.
Yeah. Now check it out.
Here's some for now.
here's some abundance shock for you. With all the people you deal with and you're out there, what if you had your TSU link, right? and you said, hey, this is great, I love this, here, sign up under me, here's my link. And they know it doesn't cost anything. They want you to help them promote on social media anyway, so you're just giving them another tool. Here, use this tool, sign up here. So now you've got all these freaking people under you just by default of you're out there doing what you're doing anyway, but you're just giving them this little link. Here, go here. This is one of the tools I use. So then they start using it, and they build up, and then that helps you and makes you even bigger, and it's that cooperative thing. You know what I mean? So it's a simple way to help yourself, too. And it doesn't cost anything. Quite the opposite.
So it's a whole different world paradigm that we're coming into, which is very interesting. It's very interesting to be here at this time on Earth.
I think it's one of the most exciting times. And now, I mean, with the internet making the world smaller and having these conversations available and uncensored to an extent.
Mm-hmm. When I was a kid, I used to be jealous that I missed the 60s. Like, man, it was so cool back then.
I think today is like...
love and all that. And then now it's like fast forward. It's like the 60s ain't got shit on today. It's got nothing on today. The 60s was kindergarten, seriously. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Hey, Dave. So we're coming up at the 12 o'clock mark. I would like to give Isabelle a chance to tell us where we can find her online. And
good idea.
Yeah, we can wrap this up.
Yeah, I need to shut
up. So you can find me. My website is thebellavie.com. And here, I'll put it in the chat box. It's thebellavie.com. And I have blog posts on travel, I have blog posts on being an online entrepreneur, and I have a Facebook group, The Beautiful Bella Vistas. You could search it, or you can, once you get to my website, there's a little newsletter sign up. You could get my free little ebook on my story, and then how, like, don't make the mistakes I made in 7 years, like, just start up in 1 year, and also an invitation to the Facebook group. And then I'm on Twitter, BellaV92, and the same on YouTube, BellaV92. Where else am I at? Tumblr, thebellav.tumblr.com. But if you go to my website, you can find all those buttons on my website. And I always love hearing from people. My email address is thebellavproject@gmail.com.
Beautiful. And
you can find me all in those places.
Join the Bellavie side of the Force. Yeah. You dominate your destiny. Execute Order 92.
Thank you so much, Isabelle, for coming out and talking to us. And
oh, and Katerina, give your information.
Yes. You know,
you're just as important.
Yes.
Don't cock block yourself, girl.
Oh, I was giving her
good call.
Spotlight. Yeah, I'm KaterinaRoy.com, so that's where I am at. I do energy healing with people, and I have my little opt-in at the moment. It's your inner beauty makeover, so helping people kind of understand more about what's going on inside of their brain and how it's reflecting into their health and their wellness and their vitality and all of that. So
okay.
You can find that there, and all of my other links and everything are on the website too. So KaterinaRoy.com.
Thanks so much for having me on the Google Hangout today. It's been fun.
Yeah, we
did. Fun?
We definitely have to do this again.
Yes.
Yeah, and the text chat does not get seen in the video, so if you were putting up those links for the benefit of the viewing audience, they didn't see anything.
They will be on the YouTube replay, though.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, well, I mean, when people watch it, obviously you spoke them, so, you know, they have a brain, they can use it, so. Yes, thank you. Let's definitely do this again at some point in the future. This has been fun, and there are more people who could also join us, too, but I told, you know, the other PSEC crew, I'm like, well, I don't want to put too much pressure on Isabella. She knows Katerina. She doesn't know me. I don't want her to feel overwhelmed. So
Isabelle.
Three of us for now. I didn't want to, like, totally break your brain because all of us in the PSEC crew are just as passionate and outspoken as me and Katerina. So I didn't want your brain to be like,
No, this stuff is, I love this stuff, and it's not,
okay.
It's very hard to storytell this kind of stuff because it's coming from a space of nothing.
I mean, we could definitely in the near future get a bigger conversation going with more like-minded people. I just didn't want your brain to, like, crack and have you have an aneurysm due to, like, overload. So it's just a matter of consideration, you know.
Thank you so much. Well, I'm going to head out, but I will see you guys on social media, and then let me know when you want to do it again.
All right, sounds good. Bye. Have a great rest of your day.
Dark side.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you, everybody, for... Oh, you're still here, Katerina?
I was just trying to close out my computer. I was having a moment.
Crash differently. That killed my inner child. Okay, well, thank you, everybody, for watching. I hope you found this to be informative and enjoyable and completely crazy in a good way. And we will see you next time. And may the boss be with you. And make sure you drink Lucid Dreaming Tea at luciddreamingtea.com. Made with 100% pure kangaroo cock. May the force of the bat sign be with you. Drink the tea, and forever shall it dominate your destiny. Later.